Welcome to the Tundra Connections program. Today we have a very exciting treat. We're doing a class for our changing environment, an undergraduate climate class at the University of Colorado at Boulder. I'm Jen Kay, and I'm the professor of that class. I don't normally teach my class from the Tundra, but I'm pretty excited to be doing that today. So welcome to all the students in my class, and BJ is just bringing up a picture of a polar bear we have right outside. I know we had pretty cold temperatures in Boulder today, so you probably felt like a little bit of the Arctic was there. Well, it's certainly cold up here, and we have some polar bears who've dug a little hole for themselves to get out of the wind and stay warm. So welcome also to Peak to Peak High School, and teachers, we're really excited you could join the class. It's polar bear season here in Churchill, and we're coming to you live from Tundra Buggy 1 on the shores of Hudson Bay with Arctic winds and polar bears right outside. The audience for our broadcast today is high school and college students. And as I said, I'm a professor at the University of Colorado, and I'm really thankful to PBI and their sponsors for letting me do this class from the Tundra. Their sponsors include the Frontiers North Buggy Adventures, who have provided this wonderful buggy that we're on and are enabling us to look at the polar bears that are right outside. So to hear a little bit about where we are, I'm going to turn it over to one of the other panelists here, and maybe just a short introduction, Terry, and a little bit about where we are.
Absolutely. My name is Terry Goddard. I'm the Director of Programming for the Center for Global Education, and I come from Canada, actually, so I'm not quite as far from home as you are, Jen. And we are in the middle of the Canadian tundra. Now, you see in here on a Google Earth shot, we're going to zoom right in and down onto Churchill, Manitoba, which is on the western shore of the Hudson Bay. And it's a community of about 900 people, which this is an interesting fact. Between the months of about June and November, there are as many polar bears as there are people here. So it's not the biggest place, and they tend not to like to hang out in the same places, thankfully, because that wouldn't be all that safe. But that's kind of what Churchill is, and we're about 15 miles out from there. And we're on the in a little buggy that's called the Tundra Buggy Number 1, and needless to say, it's like a big bus on monster wheels, right? So if you had any challenging topography to get over, this would be the vehicle to take, and that's what we're coming to you live from today.
Great, thanks so much, Terry. We have about 35 minutes with you all today, and this is going to be a class about the Arctic and the tundra. We're going to learn about polar bears, and I'm going to introduce a couple of the other panelists we have with us that are going to help. So maybe starting all the way at the end with Stefan.
Hello, everyone. My name is Stefan Peterson. I'm the head of conservation and research at Assiniboine Park Zoo, which is in Winnipeg, fairly close to here, so a few hours by flight south of here. And my research at the zoo includes some polar bear research and also ring seal and harbor seal research, as well as I've studied everything from shrews and fleas and tarantulas all the way up to bowhead whales.
Great, thanks so much. And some of you I know submitted some questions, which we'll get to directly for Stefan. But I'm joined actually very specially also by a polar bear biologist. Elisa, can you introduce yourself a little bit about yourself?
Hi, everybody. My name is Elisa McCall. I started my polar bear research here in 2010. I worked for Dr. Andy DeRoche on my master's degree following the polar bears that we had GPS collars on. I'm now working for Polar Bears International as of this year as the field programs manager, and a big part of my job is doing this outreach, education sort of thing. I'm also staying involved in the research, especially with this population of polar bears here, so it's been really exciting.
Cool. Thanks so much, Elisa. Pretty neat career, huh? Yeah. So before we get started with the class, I thought we would just share a couple of stories from the tundra, and I'm going to hand it off to Stefan, who had a very special camera that he brought on board, and it's similar to a camera that we had in our classroom earlier this year, so maybe Stefan can describe some of what we've been seeing.
Yeah, for sure. One of the interesting things that I've been able to do on my trip up here this fall is test out some new technology, at least new technology to me. And that's thermal imaging technology. So I have a, I brought up a FLIR camera, which I guess you guys had in your class earlier in the year. And really, I'm just trying to figure out if we can use that technology to look at the energetics of polar bears. So where are they losing heat? How well insulated are they? And then use that sort of information to look at their energy budget throughout the year.
Really cool. So we were looking at thermal infrared images to try to understand that everything emits radiation, greenhouse gases, and polar bears apparently are no exception.
Yeah. So we had some trouble with a tundra buggy the other night, and so we were out and we were all on bear watch. So I put the camera into use trying to pick up bear signatures so that the people on the ground fixing things didn't get chomped.
And it was by far the most useful of all the tools that were there, right? The flashlights only had this little radius, and you never see if you could actually see what's out there.
Yeah.
But the infrared camera was perfect.
Yeah.
So there are a ton of bears here, and maybe I'll turn it over to Elisa for a little bit of Polar Bears 101. Who are these bears outside, and why are they here right now?
Sure. So we have 19 different subpopulations of polar bears across the Arctic. Canada has about two-thirds of the world's polar bears, and then this population right here we call the Western Hudson Bay subpopulation. And we've been studying these bears since 1980, so we have a really fantastic data set on them to go along with the satellite images of the sea ice and our other climate data that we have. So we know that the polar bears in this region, they've been declining in their number over the past 30 years. They're reproducing less, and they're a little bit smaller. And this is really tied to the sea ice patterns in the area. So if there's nothing else you ever learn about polar bears, you should know that they absolutely need sea ice. They are a marine mammal. They are completely tied to the sea ice to hunt seals on. They use it to find mates and to travel. They're not omnivores like the other bear species. They are pretty much complete carnivores. They absolutely do eat some other terrestrial foods, but they really need the fat from the seals. That's what makes a polar bear, and that's what keeps their body going. And so what's been happening in this region is that we have annual sea ice in Hudson Bay. So that means that it melts completely in the summer, and then it freezes up in the winter. And so historically, polar bears would come on shore for that summer period when there's no sea ice. And that's okay because they would have eaten enough seals to get enough body fat to live off for that terrestrial period. But what's happening now is that that sea ice isn't as around as long as it used to be. So basically, it's freezing up a little bit later on trend. You know, over a long period of time, it's been freezing up later, and then it's breaking up a little bit earlier. And that's just extending the on-land period that polar bears have, which means over time they're getting fewer calories. And if you're getting fewer calories, you know, it's hard to produce as many babies and to get as big. And so that's kind of why we're concerned. And all our climate models show that Hudson Bay sea ice will be continuing this trend well into the mid-century, when we think we might be completely ice-free in Hudson Bay by 2050. And ice-free means polar bear-free, and we don't want that to happen.
Cool, Lisa, that's really neat. I can tie that into some of the things we've been talking about in my class. So we've looked at some of the satellite data and seen how since when I was born in the late 1970s, we've lost about half of the Arctic sea ice. And we hadn't really tied it specifically to what was going on with a specific species like the polar bears. But I think making some of those connections and hearing exactly how those things fit together is pretty interesting. So just by way of review from the class, we've talked about, and maybe Vijay could bring up the map of the global warming over the last 100 years. It's really warm just about everywhere. So a map of the global warming, the first one you had. It's really warm just about everywhere over the last 100 years. And this is a figure that comes from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report. And it's based on the observations that we have. And we really can't explain this warming using just natural forcing. So there's another graph that we have that shows, it's one over from the map, that, no, one more. There we go, that one. So these are some climate model simulations that are also part of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report. And what you see is actually two different sets of simulations. So the blue simulations, which have a pretty flat temperature over time, those are the ones that have the natural forcing only. The red simulations that increase as you get towards the end of the period, those are the ones that include both the natural and the human forcing. And the black line, which is basically in the middle of the model simulations with both the human and the natural forcing, those are the observations. So some pretty clear evidence from the climate models that we really can't explain what we're seeing in terms of warming and in terms of sea ice loss by natural things alone. We really need this increased greenhouse effect, similar to what we were seeing in the FLIR images. So really neat stuff. All right, so we've talked a little bit about polar bears and about the greenhouse effect and about sea ice, but I guess one of the questions I had from one of the students in my class, Jacqueline, she asks, what does the food web for polar bears look like, and what is our role in protecting Arctic biodiversity?
Yeah, I can definitely bit about that. So the Arctic food web, some people think of it as a fairly simple food web, but when you get to it, it's quite complex, like many are. So if we start in at the very bottom, the lower trophic levels, we have algae, we have phytoplankton, and they're living not only in the water, but they're also living in the sea ice, so in little brine channels, and they're food for larger fish, so cod and small invertebrates, and those are eaten by things like seals, and then seals go up into the top level, and currently the top level of that food chain is polar bears and humans. So that's kind of where it is now and where we'd like to keep it, although we do know that there are some changes or some indications of change, like the increase observations of killer whales. So maybe a switch from polar bears as the top predator to killer whales as the top predator when there's more open wash ocean.
Cool, so more killer whales in the Arctic. And have you actually seen killer whales up here?
Yeah, I haven't. We've had reports of them around this area in Churchill pretty consistently over the last about 5 years. When I was in the high Arctic and in a place where they do see killer whales regularly, I was part of a team that was tagging killer whales, one of the first times that killer whales have been tagged in the eastern Arctic. So they're incredible. Yeah.
Moving in. All right, maybe sort of a related question. This one's from Yasmin, who's also a student in my class. And she asks, can we see effects of global warming in the polar bear population? I'm going to turn this over to Elisa, and maybe you could talk a little bit, too, about the citizen science project that you guys have going on up here, too, with PBI.
Sure. So in this population, because we have this very long data set that I mentioned, we have been able to see these impacts related to climate warming and sea ice loss. So they are getting smaller, they're reproducing less, and you can see that there's some body changes out here in these polar bears. So one of the things that PBI is doing, we have this kind of pilot research project going. We're figuring some kinks out, but the goal is that we can have all these people that come up. So we get hundreds of people come up to take pictures of polar bears every year. Well, why don't we just use that information? So what we're trying to do is figure out how we can take a picture of a polar bear and find out how far it is away from the camera, get an idea of its size, and then look at its body condition. And now we have photographs that go back a couple decades of polar bears at this time of year. And if we can get an idea from photographic evidence that these polar bears are either in stable condition or declining condition just in general, it's a really cool photographic record of what's happening to this population. And there's really no other place like this where people can come and see so many polar bears and get so many pictures. And it's just, we hope that it can be a really neat tool for us up here.
That's really cool. It's really cool to see PBI sort of bringing in citizen science and then trying to do some research and involving some of the tourists that are up here. It's really cool. Mm-hmm. So before we go on with some more science, maybe I'll turn it over to Terry just to tell us a little bit about the center that he works at and some of the connections that we've made this week with students.
Absolutely. So we've linked together hundreds of students from all across North America who come and are passionate to learn about polar bears, really all the way down from kindergarten kids all the way up to high school kids in grade 12. And some of them have done research beforehand, so they've been kind of researching their own effects of climate change in their communities, and they share it with the scientists who are here, and they've talked about some of the actions they believe need to be taken around climate change and heard some of the challenges that we've heard up here. And all of them have come away with just a renewed sense of action, you know, that needs to be taken place. And that through having a thorough understanding of climate change, having a thorough understanding of how everything all fitting together, that even the kids as young as the grade, as the kindergartens, there was one who sent out a tweet today about how they had a chant, how they were going to become eco-warriors.
Cool.
But all based on that knowledge of just knowing how it all fits together and how that needs to turn into action.
Very cool. Yeah, we've had some great connections, and it's been some of the highlight of my week to see these students so excited. Some of the best questions we've had, rivaling, I think, the questions from the class that I teach at CU were from basically elementary school kids. It's pretty impressive stuff. But speaking of good questions, this is one that actually came up in my class based on a New York Times article that came out. Christian asked this question. So with sea ice melting earlier in the season, polar bears have begun to encounter snow geese and their nesting grounds as a potential new food source. Mm-hmm. So do you think this is the type of food source that's going to help sustain polar bears when they have less sea ice and so less of a platform to hunt seals? And I'll turn this question over to Elisa.
Sure. So it's a really great question, and this is something that comes up in the news a lot. And you know, it is really interesting. So we've known that polar bears like to eat birds and eggs, and even caribou when they have the chance to. We've known that for hundreds of years, actually. What's really cool in this area is that we can see that maybe polar bears are eating that a little more often now. So maybe they're having to seek out that food more often. They are eating a lot of eggs. There's a lot of eggs to take here in the summer. There's a lot of geese around. I think the problem that we encounter when we talk about this terrestrial feeding is that when we just focus on, okay, they're eating eggs, it's new food, we're kind of ignoring the basic biology of polar bears. So the calories that come from eggs, there's just not enough terrestrial calories to sustain this population. Maybe it'll keep some, you know, a small percentage of some adult males going a little bit longer, but there's not the fat content on land that polar bears need. So there's a reason that the grizzly and black bears in this region are some of the smallest in the world. The landscape, it doesn't have the fat, the calories, anything like that to really sustain like 900 polar bears. It's just not going to happen. So while it's very interesting that polar bears are coming off land or coming onto land, they're here longer, they're trying to eat more land foods because they're hungry, that doesn't translate into gaining weight, thriving, or even reproducing more cubs. It's not an equal thing here. So we will expect that maybe they'll even increase more terrestrial feeding. But, you know, it's hard for polar bears. They're not going to run a caribou down in the summer. They're going to overheat. They might get lucky and find a carcass or something like that. Maybe an adult male could get really lucky and take down a sick one or a calf, maybe. But this isn't a sustainable plan. It's not something polar bears can adapt to. They're marine animals, and they need that sea ice, and they need those seals. And that's really what it boils down to. We're not going to save, you know, the polar bear populations with some goose eggs, basically.
Great, that's really interesting, Elisa. Thanks for clearing that up. It was really good to see that question come
up. It's really
and get answered by a polar bear expert. That's really cool. So another question that I've had, we've been watching and following the developments in the Winnipeg Zoo, Stefan, and I guess you guys have a couple of new polar bears that have arrived. And so a question from Elisa in my class, how do you mimic the living conditions for a polar bear at a zoo? And also maybe a related question from Sophia. She's wondering, what was the process for getting these polar bears from the Arctic to the zoo?
Yeah, I think I'll answer them in reverse order,
actually. Okay, cool.
So Manitoba is pretty unique in that Manitoba Conservation and Water Stewardship feels that all of these polar bears are important, and they want people to be making changes in the south to reduce climate emissions and slow that loss of sea ice. And so one of the tools that they think is valuable is by having polar bears in appropriate facilities in the south. We zoos and aquariums get so much traffic, and they have such a potential for teaching people about polar bears and making this connection between people and animals. And then another kind of piece is to educate people and to get them to make changes that will help keep polar bears in the wild. So So Manitoba Conservation has come up with a system where they try and make sure that polar bears stay in the wild around Churchill and in other places, but when there's bears that would otherwise die, they're able to pull them in and send them to a facility like ours. So they come down. Sometimes we have polar bear cubs like we have had recently, but there's also room for problem bears that would normally be euthanized. So one of our bears came down that way. So when they come down, we're really, it's challenging to make a zoo, a facility like that, exactly the same as the Arctic. So we have a number of different methods. We have spaces for them that are as large as we possibly can make down in at Assiniboine Park Zoo. We have a really great program of enrichment and training to try and get their brains active and getting them learning different behaviors. And then one of the advantages we have too is we have multiple bears. So even though we all think of polar bears as this solitary predator on the landscape, for a large part of the year, many bears are interacting with others, and that's quite a complex and rich kind of part of their life. So with having multiple bears, we can get them learning to be bears as opposed to just being really keyed in on humans. They have other examples of how to be a bear.
Neat. Yeah, so they get some of that polar bear interaction. Mm-hmm. Lisa, maybe you could tell us a little bit about what you've seen. How do polar bears interact with each other?
So it's pretty neat when they're on land. We think that when they're on the sea ice, they probably don't interact too much. Now, we don't know a lot about that, but that's what we think is most usual, is that they kind of are solitary. When they're on land, they're a bit more friendly, especially when the temperatures go down. I don't know if it's because they're bored or they maybe are this like naturally social animal, but we do see polar bears playing with each other, and it is just so cool. So what you're seeing on your screen now, we call sparring. And this can be, it's usually two males, often two younger ones. Kind of the old guys are over it, I think, a little bit. But basically what they're trying to do is they're trying to figure out how they stack up against other polar bears. They're getting a bit of muscle memory when it comes to fighting. When they enter into the spring, they're going to be competing for mates. And so it's pretty helpful for them to kind of suss out their own abilities now when their stakes aren't very high and when one of them can turn tail if it gets too intense and they're not really going to lose out on anything. So we are seeing a lot of this. We've actually seen two bears hanging around the last few days pretty close together. We actually think they might be siblings from how close they are, and they keep licking each other and breaking off into little fights and wrestling matches. It's not always on the back hind legs whacking at each other. These two have been rolling around on top of each other and laying on each other and biting their feet, and it's really cool to watch that sort of interaction with each other. Really neat.
Cool. So they're preparing for some of the later parts in their life, which will involve going out on the sea ice and getting some seals.
And fighting over girls.
And fighting over girls and mating. Wow. Yeah, sounds kind of similar to some of the human stuff. So I guess I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit, since sea ice is so important to polar bears, just a little bit about how we know about sea ice. So we know about it both from satellite images that we see from the late 1970s, but also from climate models. And climate models are a tool that we've talked about in my class as a way to try to understand what's happening, why it's happening, and what we expect for the future. And the future piece is really an important one, because if you want to know about the future, pretty hard to just go observe it, right?
Yeah, good luck.
You probably need to use a model. So one of the things that I wanted to talk to you guys about a little bit is something that I call the heartbeat of the Arctic. And maybe BJ can bring up, have a movie. This is a movie from a climate model, and it just shows the sea ice, and it's the annual cycle of the sea ice, and it looks a little bit like a heartbeat. And over time, there's been less and less sea ice in all times of the year, but it still expands out during the winter when it gets cold and contracts in the summer when it gets warm. So in addition to this kind of heartbeat, which is the seasonal cycle, there's also some variability. And so if we look at long-term trends in sea ice, we'll see some years there's more sea ice and some years there's less sea ice. And that's really just part of the variability in the system. You know, just like you can't say it's colder in Boulder today than it is in the Arctic, there's no such thing as global warming. If sea ice goes up 1 year or goes down 1 year, you're not going to call that climate. Climate is a 30-year average. So you have to remember that when you're looking at things. And I gave a talk last night actually for some of the tourists and made an analogy that actually came out of some of the press coverage for one of my papers. And yeah, it was, I don't know if it was, if you guys thought it was a good analogy or not.
It was good.
But it was, yeah, talking about the band Guns N' Roses and some analogies between Guns N' Roses and future sea ice trends. So basically what we see is that on short time scales, it's really hard to predict what's going to happen. There's a lot of variability. Just like, I don't know if Guns N' Roses is going to get together for a revival tour or, you know, what's going to happen with them. But unfortunately, on the long term, it really doesn't seem like Guns N' Roses is going to be on tour. 2050, you know, Terry's kids are probably not going to be going to see Guns N' Roses.
They might not be the biggest Guns N' Roses fan. Axl Rose might not be on their posters on my daughter's wall.
Yeah. So this is kind of what some of the projections show for future of sea ice, that on the short term, we don't really know what's going on. But if we continue to increase greenhouse gases, it's really inevitable that sea ice is going to melt away. And so it's really a pretty important message to get out that we need to do things to reduce greenhouse gases if we want to maintain polar bears in their natural environment and also make things a better planet for us. And maybe I'll turn it over to Stefan for a little bit just to talk about whatever your reactions to this. I mean, having heard about this, and yeah, what do you think? I mean, there's other species also aside from polar bears too, but
yeah, well, I'm pretty concerned. I mean, I really have an affinity for the Arctic environment. I've done quite a few years either doing genetics projects on narwhal or beluga or bowhead whales. In the last few years, I've really focused more and more on looking at the kind of dynamics around Churchill with a couple of seal species that we have here, the ring seals and harbor seals. And we know ring seals are super well adapted to life in ice, and they're adapted to ice. And as we see less ice, especially in the spring when they're pupping, we're looking at maybe decreases in the number of ring seals. But in ecosystems, there's usually winners and losers. And so one of the winners, we think, might be harbor seals. So harbor seals aren't really well adapted to ice. And we expect their population to increase over time as that ecosystem changes. And really, the question as we look out at polar bears sleeping in the snow around us is, what kind of implications will that have for polar bears? So will they be able to switch over to harbor seals to get a lot of that nutrition and a lot of that fat? And based on the biology, which we're learning more and more about, we don't actually think that's going to be a one-for-one trade. Ring seals, they're up as babies in dens underneath the snow but on the ice, and they don't go into the water very much, and they just gain weight and become these little blubber balls. And that's what polar bears really are targeting in the spring, the early spring. Harbor seals, they're pupping inshore. They're putting on not as much weight when they're pups, and they're also in the water and much less available for polar bears at that time of year. So we don't actually think they're going to be comparable and be able to trade. It's really all those interconnected pieces that I find completely fascinating.
Yeah, a related question we had from several of the students. Thank you so much for giving me your questions in advance, both the Peak to Peak students and the students in my class. It's really great and helped us put together the program that you're watching today. One of them that several of you asked was about whether or not polar bears can mate with brown bears, and if that can be, you know, if they can just adapt to the changing environment. And maybe I'll turn that over to Alisa to talk about that a little bit.
Sure. So we do know that polar bears and brown bears can and do mate, and we think that this has probably been happening for, you know, the history since polar bears split from brown bears hundreds of thousands of years ago. They're able to come together. Their offspring, again, are able to mate. The hybrids do mate themselves. So it's a little bit messy. You know, evolution isn't this perfect split and then new direction. It kind of can get a little ugly in there. But I think the thing to realize is that even though polar bears and grizzly bears do mate, and they make very interesting looking roller bears, this isn't the way that we're going to help polar bears. We want to preserve polar bears as a species. We're not going to ever get a new species of roller bear. That's not really how it works. We're still learning a lot about this, this mixing, this hybrid, but we don't really, you know, we don't know a lot about it, but we do know that polar bears are not going to all of a sudden start mating with all these brown bears and kind of become this half terrestrial, half marine bear. That's not kind of in the future. That's not really how, you know, the genetics are going to work. So we really need to preserve the sea ice, to preserve the polar bears. It's a little bit defeatist to think like, oh, well, they'll just mate with other things and kind of turn into something else. That's not really how it happens. And plus, that would take a very long period of time. And we really don't have that time at all based on all the science and data and climate models that we have.
Yeah. I know, Stefan, you do quite a bit of work with genetics. Maybe can you give some insights? Maybe also bringing in the sea ice, like if the sea ice does decline and we do have, you know, sort of fewer habitats for polar bears, what kind of concerns we might have?
Yeah. The growler bears, the hybrid kind of things, we see hybrids forming in a number of places throughout the world. As the climate changes and things move into new areas. And really, in the Canadian Arctic, we're just seeing it in really one place. We're interested around here because we have tundra grizzlies expanding their range and we have polar bears. So we're on the lookout, but we don't actually think that that's going to happen across the Arctic. And it's really quite interesting that something strange is happening in that Western Arctic that's causing these hybrids. And I've forgotten what your second part
was. Oh, yeah. I guess I was just a little... One of the questions was how important genetic diversity is for a population. And, you know, if you have the sea ice going away and you have sort of fewer habitats for polar bears, what that does to the biodiversity and genetic diversity.
Yeah, and that's a really great question. And one we're kind of quite interested in. A lot of times... Well, and we know from... what polar bears have right now for genetic complement is they have gone through bottlenecks before, and they have survived and they've increased back to the numbers that we have today. But we also know that when they were going through those bottlenecks, it was at a longer time scale, and it didn't have all the anthropogenic effects at the same time, so all the human pressure at the same time. So one of the things that might occur, and again, we don't really know what's going to happen, is as populations get smaller, they tend to get isolated, we lose genetic diversity, and if you lose genetic diversity, a lot of times you're losing the genes you need to adapt to whatever the environment is going to throw at you. And sometimes that means you're losing genes to combat different diseases. Sometimes that means you're losing genes for something that you need in your environment, whether that's metabolizing fat or coat color or whatever it is. You can have all these losses. And the general consensus is once you lose a gene for something, you usually don't get that back. It's gone. You may get a new pathway, but that's very, very rare. So big concerns over the long term. Polar bears can really move wide distances, and Canada is kind of a piece of land that we expect to have polar bears longest in Canada, but for many other species we see them isolated in different parts of their ranges and really have small population size problems.
Great, well, we're just about ready to wrap up, and I guess I'm just going to go to all of our panelists for just, you know, what would you tell a high school student or a college student if you just had a couple minutes to share with them, you know, your experience this week up on the tundra? We'll start with you, Terry.
Absolutely. Well, to me, one of our models at the Center for Global Education is that education, that learning without action is like food without exercise, and that is actually not good for you. Right, if I just sit and I watch television, it doesn't matter how healthy my food is, if all I'm doing is watching and consuming what's being given to me and I'm not turning it into action, I'm going to get fat, I'm going to get out of weight, and I'm going to develop diseases, heart disease, and those same things. But I think there's a parallel in education as well, that all we do is if we sit back and we absorb to teach a test or to get a mark, as opposed to saying, I'm going to learn this to put it into action, I think we actually then become apathetic. We see it in voter turnout. We had the worst voter turnout in the United States in the last 7 decades for this last set of elections. And I think that what we need to do in our high schools and our universities is constantly be pushing not towards a test mark, but to be pushing towards how is this information going to empower me to change the planet. And I'm hoping that that's what, I mean, we from this time that we've got to spend with Dr. K, that we know her passion that's there. And I hope that it's coming through for you guys too.
Great, thanks, Terry. Yeah, maybe Stefan?
Sure. One of the things that I'd like to emphasize is my background is genetics and biology, and I've always kind of been focused on that science, natural science sort of path. But there's a lot of different paths that can give you the tools to make a difference. So right now at our zoo and at many other places, we have people that are game designers that are helping create apps that can track climate change and make, or climate change actions and make them more aware and bring people together to make changes. There's people that are using their art in order to communicate different concepts and get people stirred to action. We have sociologists and people that are studying how people react in order to try and find the best way to communicate information to different groups, and educators, and then there's also people who are doing, you know, the physics and the modeling and the genetics to learn about the species and the ecosystems. So make sure you keep your kind of mind open to all the ways you can use your own skill set towards making a positive sort of change and impact on the world around you, whether that's the community or the globe.
Thanks so much. Elisa?
Well, man, they sure covered a lot of it. I guess all I would say is just you guys are in such a cool time of your life right now, whether you're in high school or you're doing your undergrad degree. There are just so many opportunities and doors waiting for you to open them. If you're interested in something, just go after it. Whether you learn that you don't like it or whether you learn that you love it, that's a good learning experience. Don't be afraid to take advantage of the mentors that are around you. I'm where I am today because I had some really great people in my life, professors, older grad students, things like that, that really encouraged me and, you know, helped me make choices. I never thought I would be a polar bear biologist. I loved animals. I wanted to do something with that, but it's not like I set myself on polar bears. I actually studied mice. I studied toads. You know, I worked at all these different animal places, and this is where I ended up just because of who I met. I worked really hard in school. That never hurts. Trust me. I know it's sometimes frustrating to study for your midterms or finals, but you know, it's really important that you work hard. People do notice. And just, like, good luck with everything. You guys have great opportunities ahead of you, and you really honestly can do great things and make big changes if you want to. So go for it.
Well, there's 3 inspiring messages for you all. Thank you so much, you all. So we're at the end of our time with you today, and I guess we'll just do a little bit of wrap-up. I'm really thankful to Polar Bears International for letting us do this webcast, and I hope you guys enjoyed it in Colorado or wherever you're watching from. Polar Bear International's goal is to keep polar bears in the Arctic always, and it's really important to remember that time remains for saving polar bears and their sea ice habitat, and we really all need to do our part to make that happen. So thank you for what you're already doing, which is, you know, taking a class, learning more, you know, and helping reduce greenhouse gas emissions. That's really what's going to help in the long term to make sure we have sea ice. Remember that your actions, while small, can really be grouped with other people's actions and have a huge impact when scaled up. So our real thanks also to PBI's platinum sponsors, Frontiers North Buggy Adventures and Canada Goose. They provided these wonderful coats that we're wearing. Are you guys all stayed pretty warm?
Oh, yeah.
We are warm.
All right. Support has also been provided by Pearls of the Planet, a project of explore.org, a direct charitable activity of the Annenberg Foundation. We're also grateful to Telestream, the makers of Wirecast, Parks Canada, Discovery Education, the Center for Global Education, and Taking It Global. So thanks everyone, and I'll see you guys back in Colorado, or hope to meet you sometime soon if I haven't. And yeah, say goodbye, panel. I guess we'll just
bye.
Call it the end there. Thanks a lot, guys.